Okay, could I ask members who are leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible? We move on to the final item of business today, which is a members' business debate on motion 8046 in the name of Ross Greer on Save Loch Lomond. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd encourage members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible, and I call on Mr Greer to open the debate around 7 minutes, please. Mr Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I should say from the outset to the local residents in Balloch, who I know are watching on Parliament TV, that my apologies for how long this has taken. I hope it's worth the wait for them. And I should say at the outset, a thank you to Green and SNP colleagues who supported this motion and enabled this evening's debate. I'm particularly grateful to that, given that the last time I raised this issue via a member's business debate was just 9 months ago. There have been some major developments in this saga since that point, though, most notably a major revision to Flamingoland's application, which I'll come to in a moment. Firstly, though, I hope colleagues will indulge me in providing a brief history of how the last 7 years have led us to this point. And it has been a seven-year process. I'd highlight that number to emphasise just how exhausting this has been for the local community, who have now had this threat hanging over them for the best part of a decade. Flamingoland's first formal application was lodged and dealt with 4 years ago. The application was for a tourist resort on a massive scale, sitting on the banks of Loch Lomond at Balloch, on what is currently largely publicly owned land. The plans included 125 woodland lodges, largely to be situated in the ancient woodland at Drumkinnon Woods, as well as a hotel, a water park, a monorail and more. Iconic lochside views were to be interrupted by buildings that local residents quite fairly described as garish. And publicly owned land was to be used to generate profits for a private company based hundreds of miles away in Yorkshire, and which certainly would not be reinvesting it in the local community and economy. Flamingoland's own environmental impact assessment made for particularly grim reading, speaking of, amongst other things, damage to ancient woodland, pollution of standing and running water, red squirrel and otter fatalities, and a host of other environmental concerns. That was from their own documentation. As you may recall, local residents and I formed the Save Loch Lomond campaign, through which we lodged over 60,000 objections. This made Flamingoland the most unpopular planning application in Scottish history. We were joined in objecting by the Woodland Trust, Rambler Scotland and Western Bartonshire Council. The application was so clearly contrary to local and national planning policy that the National Park's own planning officers recommended that their board reject it. Rather than face that loss, Flamingoland withdrew their application with just days to go before the hearing. That was in 2019. We knew that they would come back, so it was no surprise that a fresh application was lodged last year. That application was for 127 lodges, 2 hotels, a water park, a monorail, up to 21 apartments, a brewery, a pub, a restaurant, a boathouse, and all to be served by 393 parking spaces. They tried to squeeze almost as much in as they did the first time, but into a smaller space. They told us that the ancient woodland at Drumkinnon Wood had been taken out of the application and lodges moved elsewhere on the site. But any suspicions that Flamingoland had turned into tree huggers, thanks to our influence, were short-lived. The details of the plans still showed that an area of Drumkinnon Wood, marked in the application as Area 10, was earmarked for destruction, as were sections of ancient woodland alongside Woodbank House and the proposed boathouse. But even the supposedly saved bulk of Drumkinnon Wood may be endangered by these plans. They're currently under the ownership of Scottish Enterprise, a public body. Should planning permission be granted for the site, Flamingoland get the woods too? When they were still speaking to me, that's some time ago, Flamingoland told me that the economic viability of the site rested on being able to develop in the ancient woodland. It's hard to believe that should they take ownership of the woods, or even a long-term lease, that they wouldn't seek at some point to exploit them for financial benefit. Last year's plans were seriously flawed, left so many questions unanswered, and made a number of contradictory claims. So on my behalf, the planning and environmental law expert Ian Cowan submitted a detailed letter of objection flagging every one of these issues to the National Park. And in response, and for which I'm grateful, their planning department essentially put the process on hold, demanding that the developer resubmit a number of documents and respond to 16 requests on everything from clarification of contradictory statements on parking provision and ancient woodland loss to how the proposals could possibly meet the high bar set by National Planning Framework 4. And just 2 weeks ago, Flamingoland responded, so this is a timely debate. They've reduced the number of lodges planned to 104 and parking spaces to 372 to allow for the staff and service area to be relocated from Area 10, the bit of ancient woodland. This is welcome, and I want to congratulate the local residents who worked really hard to protect that bit of Drumkinnon Wood. But the ancient woodland isn't safe from sell-off, and as described by the Woodland Trust's briefing circulated to MSPs, other sections of ancient woodland are still under threat. There are so many flaws in this third attempt at a proposal. It's still much bigger than the visitor experience space zoned in the National Parks Planning Policy. It would be a scar on a world-famous landscape. The Landscape and Visual Impact Assessment admits that there would be adverse effects. Flamingoland keep telling us that there'd be no negative impact on access, but that's simply impossible to achieve. You can't turn a popular public space for informal recreation into a densely packed, branded and privately owned holiday lodge park without a loss of the freedom to roam. A busy attraction with 372 parking spaces certainly isn't compatible with the park's net zero objectives or the Scottish Government's policy of reducing car usage. We're all well aware, too well aware, that Loch Lomond and its communities are overwhelmed by visitors travelling by car through peak tourist season. Speak to any resident of Luss or Balmaha or Balloch itself about the stress of dealing with everything from inconsiderate parking to genuinely dangerous driving and antisocial behaviour. We want people to enjoy Loch Lomond, but we must acknowledge that some of its communities are simply at breaking point. The last thing any of us would want is the kind of oversaturation of tourism leading to deep-seated hostility from residents, which destinations like Barcelona have experienced. The park are doing excellent work to make visiting the area more sustainable and supporting local residents who are struggling with the impact of high visitor numbers. I know the Minister won't be able to say much about a life planning application, and I recognise this isn't his portfolio area, but I would appreciate if he was able to speak a little bit more about the good work that the park is doing to encourage sustainable use. There's one other area about the National Park, the Park Authority, that I want to encourage the Minister and his colleague Orna Slater to look into. Normally, with a controversial planning application, objectors would be able to contact their councillors directly and make their views heard. Even though councillors on the relevant committee, the planning committee, wouldn't be allowed to express an opinion on the plans, this feedback from residents is an important part of the process. So it's unfortunate that Loch Lomond and the Trossachs National Park is the exception here. Unlike any of the more than 500 other councils and national parks in the UK, this park doesn't publicise direct contact details for its board members. I know that many of my constituents want to address board members directly, and the fact that they have no means of doing so leaves an unacceptable democratic deficit. The views of the community in this particular case are certainly beyond a doubt. We've had two local surveys now showing opposition by a margin of around 3-1. Flamingoland's chief executive said if the community didn't support them, they would walk away. And it's very, very clear that the community don't support them, and yet here we are again. Residents certainly don't trust Flamingoland's grand claims. Not only would this substantial increase in traffic on already busy local roads clearly be to the detriment of the community, there's very little belief that the claimed economic benefits will actually materialise. Flamingoland initially promised 300 jobs for the area. This number's plummeted as the years went on. The eventual impact assessment for the 2019 application stated the equivalent of just 28 net jobs would be created in the region compared to Flamingoland didn't go ahead. And of course, many of those would be seasonal. The community is not hostile to development. I would certainly welcome the redevelopment of Woodbank House, for example. But Flamingolands are too big, too destructive, and come from a developer whose behaviour should frankly disqualify them from playing a role in the life of our national park. The community are not short of alternative ideas for some of the sites, but these can't be taken forward for as long as Flamingoland's exclusivity agreement is in place. Were that to be dropped, I think Scottish Enterprise would get a lot out of actually speaking to residents about what they want. And like in some cases in Drumkennan Wood, for example, that would be for no development to take place. Much-loved, well-used community green spaces are worth protecting, especially when they're also the gateway to our world-famous national park. In closing, Presiding Officer, 43,000 objections have been lodged to this latest application. The Woodland Trust and Ramblers Scotland have joined us in opposing it once again, and the National Trust for Scotland has now also come out against the plans. We are all motivated by a deep love for Loch Lomond and a passionate desire to protect it. We've beaten Flamingoland at every turn for 7 years now, and we are ready to do so again one last time. We are going to save Loch Lomond.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Graham. We now move to the open debate. I call first Jim Fairley, to be followed by Pam Gosell for around 4 minutes, Mr Fairley.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to thank Ros Greer for once again bringing this issue to the attention of the Parliament. As the MSP that is lucky enough to have Loch Leven on my doorstep, I know only too well the strength of feeling that myself and many of my constituents hold towards these iconic beauty spots. There, my work involves supporting those attempting to deliver long-term solutions to the local community so that they can continue to enjoy the Loch and see the ecology restored. Today's topic, however, concentrates on Loch Lomond, one of Scotland's two national parks, a place that has an emotional meaning for generations of Scots and visitors alike to our country, and where its bonnie banks mark it as a place of worldwide wonder. And it's 20 years since Scotland's first national parks in Loch Lomond and the Trossachs and the Cairngorms were established. And in that time, the parks have responsibly faced up to diversity, biodiversity and climate crisis issues, managing facilities for visitors, promoting responsible access to the land and assisting in developing sustainable communities. So it's clear to me that those entrusted with protecting our national treasures know what they're doing. And all of those who have been to Loch Lomond and witnessed its charms could easily understand why a big business or developer would want to take advantage of the site and try to capitalise on the popularity of this national treasure that welcomes millions of visitors each year. And it's right that we sit in this Parliament today at this topic, to debate this topic, given it is a site of huge significance to so many people. But ultimately, we are also correct to accept that this is a decision that is best taken locally by those whose lives will be impacted more than government ministers or MSPs who would visit the Loch and its surrounding beauty spots. The decision will be taken by the Park Authority Board, and that includes elected community representatives and local community councillors, and it is these people that we should trust to fully understand and appreciate the issue. Excuse me. In order to maintain its prestige, the National Park does impressive work each year, working closely with communities, land managers, local businesses and the third sector, and individuals aiming to support biodiversity and improve the health and well-being of the local community. The current Lomond Banks plan is in the planning process, and I'm in full agreement with the idea that Park Authority closely assesses whether or not this development has an impact on the environment and the local community. Furthermore, those making the decision will consider if it complies with the Scottish planning policy, the National Planning Framework 4, that Scotland adopted in February and has become the statutory part of the National Park Development Plan. NPF 4 will guide Scotland's net zero spatial planning journey over the next decade with the aim of delivering sustainable, livable and productive places. And it's clear that if the proposers are to be successful, that their application meets the spirit of NPF 4 and meets the needs of the National Park and its local communities. The previous Flamingo Land application was withdrawn as a result of dialogue between the developer, the Park Authority and the local community in Balloch and south of the Loch Lomond. And I'm hopeful that today's discussion during this debate in the Scottish Parliament reassures the public and all those with an interest or a bond to the park that any development will only occur after serious consideration by the rightful decision makers on the grounds that it strictly complies with NPF 4 and the Park Authority's serious considerations. And I, for one, will follow this project with interest. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. I now call Pam Gosell to be followed by Jackie Bailey. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a West of Scotland MSP, I'm honoured to have part of the Loch Lomond and the Trossachs National Park in my region. Last year, the member Ross Greer secured debating time to explore the live planning application of Loch Lomond Banks development. I felt then that it was important to remain neutral. And now, Presiding Officer, the member brings this issue to the Parliament yet again while the planning application is still alive. As such, I would hope that all contributions to this debate are respectful of the fact that due process is still to be played out. When I spoke in last year's debate on Lomond Banks, I made the point that these developments can often have a positive outcome for the local community, but only when the local community is allowed their full say on the project. With this in mind, I am pleased to see that the Lomond Banks team have been working constructively to address the concerns of residents. This work is reflected clearly in the revised application recently submitted to the Loch Lomond and the Trossachs National Park. Important revisions include those relating to the environment and local infrastructure, which Ross Greer draws attention to in today's motion. In my last contribution, I also outlined concerns about antisocial behaviour and littering. I welcome that in their legally binding Lomond Promise document, the developers have committed to deploying monitoring systems and employing suitably qualified staff to manage any antisocial behaviour within the development and its immediate surroundings. However, littering and waste management is one aspect of which further clarity would be welcomed. Another outstanding issue is that of the natural environment. I welcome the significant reductions in accommodation density in the revised plans, as well as the move to ensure there is no reduction in their input to biodiversity value. But as the Woodlands Trust has highlighted, certain areas of ancient woodland remain at risk even under the revised plans. I also welcome the promises to work with local businesses and community councils to ensure the local community sees the potential economic and social benefits of this project. The social value portal proposed by Lomond Banks would be a key part of measuring any potential benefits. But despite further assurances from Lomond Banks, concerns around local infrastructure such as roads remain a pressing issue for residents. The staggered check-in and check-out times that Lomond Banks have proposed as a solution to this promising, but we wouldn't know how effective this system is until the development has gone ahead. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, as I remarked last time, I am not opposed to developments such as this by default, but it is vital that the concerns of communities are fully heard. As such, efforts to liaison with stakeholders are welcomed, but they cannot be one-off actions. This will have to be a continued process of going back and forth to create a balance, and further concessions will likely have to be made. While there is still much work to be done, I remain hopeful that through constructive engagement system can be developed whereby it complements the local area rather than detract from it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Gosall. I now call on Jackie Bailey again, around 4 minutes, Ms. Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Let me start by congratulating Ross Crea for securing this debate, as it gives me the opportunity to speak about the constituency that I am very proud to represent. Loch Lomond is a most beautiful place with some of the most breathtaking views in all of Scotland. And it is because it is so special to my local community and to visitors from across Scotland, the UK and the world, any development must be carefully considered and properly scrutinised. Now, members will be aware that Lomond Banks, otherwise known as Flamingoland, want to develop a tourism project at Loch Lomond. It's going to be a multi-site development centred at West Riverside in Balloch, which incidentally is land owned by Scottish Enterprise, so the government have an interest. But that development will include self-catering lodges, hotels and other accommodation. Their first planning application, as Ross Greer outlined, was withdrawn. The second application, recently revised again, has taken on board some of the feedback given very clearly by the local community. And let me reflect on some of that feedback. So I conducted a survey of Balloch and indeed the surrounding area. There was a 12% return rate of several thousand survey forms issued, and of that number, 31% were in favour, 68% were against, and in 1% it was unclear whether they were in favour or not. There was a further survey conducted by the local community council where the number against was even greater than the ones I'd identified. But you know, most interest to me when you analyse the responses was that whether you agreed or disagreed with the development, people in my area had similar concerns and made similar observations. People didn't want development at Drumkinnon Woods, and the briefing from the Woodland Trust, which has already been quoted, notes that the resubmitted documents are an improvement in terms of impact on ancient woodland, but as Ross Greer has pointed out, concerns do remain and need to be addressed. People in my community wanted to be sure that the impact on the economy would be a positive one. Good jobs, paid at least the Scottish living wage, not on casual contracts, and local businesses should benefit as part of the supply chain. Now, there has been positive work by Lomond Banks to address this, and I recognise the pledges they've made to the local community. I would expect nothing less. But my local community also wanted better infrastructure and the roads dealt with. But I have to say on this point, there has been little movement. In the summer, indeed, at any point when the sun comes out, There is regularly gridlock on the A82 at Stony Mullen roundabout. And as people head to Loch Lomond, that becomes worse when you get past the roundabout. Traffic on the A811 is also affected. Now, it doesn't take much traffic for the road to grind to a halt. Adding extra vehicle movements and adding extra visitors with a development of this size will have an impact. Now, the developers say that there is minimal impact. They say that they'll encourage active travel. They will provide incentives for using the local rail services. And all of that sounds really good. But, you know, if I'm going on a self-catering holiday, I'm taking my car filled with what I need for the week or the weekend. The reality is, when you get on site, that might be helpful, but the movements of people coming on and off site will have an impact. Local knowledge matters at times like this, and so people need to be clear about that. So for the avoidance of doubt, let me be very clear. If this application is to pass, the road's infrastructure needs to be addressed, or frankly, the application shouldn't proceed. That is an absolute red line for me, because the local community have borne enough with the existing road infrastructure. Finally, Presiding Officer, given the controversy generated by the application, this is likely to end up with ministers, whatever the decision of the National Park. So I'm conscious that Lorna Slater is the Minister with responsibility for National Parks, but I believe that this would be a matter for the Planning Minister. Can the Minister confirm that my understanding is correct? Although I'm not even sure if the Butte House Agreement will still be in place by then, who knows? But what is clear, though, is that local people cannot be expected to just put up with more traffic on already difficult roads. The developer needs to work with Transport Scotland and Western Bartonshire Council to stop further traffic misery being piled onto local people, or the application should not succeed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Bailey. I now call on the Minister to wind up the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm happy to have the opportunity to close this debate on Ross Greer's motion, and thanks to him for bringing the motion, and to all the members who have taken the opportunity to make their very valid points on the record. It will, of course, be a bit difficult for me to comment much further, as members will recognise, than the Minister for Parliamentary Business did last time this subject was debated in June. As I understand it, the planning application for Lomond Banks is still live, and quite rightly, as required by the Scottish Ministerial Code, ministers are restricted from commenting publicly on live planning applications, as doing so could potentially prejudice the final decision. I'll therefore unfortunately be unable to take interventions. Applications for planning permission are dealt with in the first instance by the relevant planning authority. In this case, that is the Loch Lomond and Trossachs National Park Authority. Planning decisions within the National Park are required to have regard to the National Park Plan and be in accordance with National Planning Framework 4, along with Loch Lomond and the Trossachs National Park's Local Development Plan, unless material considerations indicate otherwise. Recognising and respecting the important role of the planning authorities in making decisions on future development in their area means it is rare for ministers to intervene in a live planning application, and they will do so only where matters of national interest are at stake. And just to confirm Jackie Bailey's point, is I understand that the planning minister would be the relevant minister in were that to happen. But what I'd like to acknowledge, though, is the interest members have in the project and in the wider running of our national parks. The Scottish Government is also a strong supporter of the work our national parks do in conserving and protecting Scotland's nature and biodiversity to make the parks a great place to visit, live and work. And both Loch Lomond and the Trossachs National Park and Cairngorm National Park continue to go from strength to strength in preserving Scotland's unique nature, while also supporting local communities, businesses and visitors. Recognising the value they bring and the potential they have in helping address the twin climate and biodiversity crisis that Scotland faces, the Scottish Government has committed to the designation of a new national park by the end of this parliamentary session. I'm sure members are aware that our national parks have a number of duties and driving objectives, including supporting their tourism economy, but the underpinning aim of the national parks, which takes precedence in any decision-making, is to conserve and enhance Scotland's natural and cultural heritage. I'm confident then that the park will apply this aim in its assessment of the Lomond Banks project. It is one of the reasons that these decisions can take so long, because there is a rigorous process of scrutiny, and this process is transparent, with information on the application published on the park's website. The opportunity is there for anyone to submit formal comments on the application. Ultimately, any decisions made are transparent and will be made in line with the park's four aims: to conserve and enhance natural cultural heritage, to promote the sustainable use of natural resources in the area, to promote understanding and enjoyment of the special qualities of the area to the public, and to promote sustainable social and economic development of the communities of the area. And as I've said, the first of these will be considered above all others where there are potential conflicts. In listening to the views expressed today, I can tell there is a lot of passion around the project. The park has indicated that updated information has been received at the request of the authority, and there is currently an opportunity for further comment. Presiding officer, the most appropriate and impactful way members can make their views known on the subject would be to feed into this process formally by submitting formal comments directly to the Loch Lomond and Trossachs National Park Authority. This can be done through the official planning portal, on their websites, by emailing them directly, or by sending a written letter to their headquarters. As the process is transparent, correspondence is published alongside the application on the portal. And I take on board the comment made by Ross Greer with regard to contacting board members. I can inform him that board members can be contacted through the board email address. In my understanding, another point you raised is that board members are not subject to the same provisions in the Local Government Act in that regard with regard to email addresses. So, comments in the form of formal representations can be submitted until the 30th of March, and while public comments can continue to be submitted after that date until a short time before the Park Authority's members meet to determine the application, it is advisable to ensure feedback is submitted within the statutory timeframe. This will help to ensure the Park Authority is able to consider all information and representations as quickly as possible and in advance of the Park Authority's meeting to determine the application. So, just in concluding, Presiding Officer, I would like to thank once again members for their thoughts on this project and for the opportunity to close this debate on behalf of the Government. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.